Recently, SpaceX announced its plan to provide better internet to people all around the world with a constellation of 4,425 broadband satellites launched between 2019 and 2024. They'll orbit in 83 different planes closer to Earth than most existing communication satellites. And SpaceX isn't stopping there. The company hopes to add another 7,500 satellites in even lower orbits for faster signals in heavily populated areas. That all sounds great, but how can we just put almost 12,000 more satellites into orbit? Space seems infinite, but there's a lot of stuff already up there. The key to adding new satellites is that they don't all go in the same place. Some satellites are in high Earth orbit, about 22,000 miles above the planet. This is a sweet spot for geosynchronous satellites. They orbit the Earth once per day, so seem to hover above one point, a great location for weather monitoring and communication satellites. Closer to home are medium Earth orbit satellites, some 12,500 miles above the Earth's surface. Orbits here are consistent and dependable, making this an ideal region for GPS satellites. And lastly, we have satellites in low Earth orbit, the area between 100 and 1200 miles above the planet. These satellites are in circular orbits that vary depending on the mission needs, and this is also where the International Space Station and Hubble Telescope orbit. It's the easiest region to get to, so a pretty popular one. Currently, there are almost 1200 operational satellites in orbit, and SpaceX wants to add more than 10 times that. But it's not like SpaceX will just throw them up there pell-mell. Satellites are launched into orbits designed not to interfere with other satellites, and satellites in the same orbit all have the same orbital velocity, meaning they all orbit at the same speed and aren't likely to hit each other. It's like a team of people driving laps in go-karts. You can't just join in and change speeds, you have to find a gap and match their pace. But satellites aren't the only thing up there. There's a lot of junk, from dead satellites to spent rocket stages and even discarded fairings. And every launch creates space junk. We've seen over 5,000 launches since the space age began in 1957, and that's created over 20,000 pieces of space junk bigger than a softball. And we can track a lot of that, but there are little bits and pieces that we can't keep tabs on. Dust from solid rocket motors, coolant from old Russian nuclear-powered satellites, even flecks of paint as small as a grain of sand. And those tiny things can pack a punch. That one fleck of paint can hit a satellite with as much force as a 550-pound object traveling at 60 miles per hour. Not all satellites can avoid this debris, but some, like the ISS, have to dodge all that junk. So SpaceX's proposed new constellation of satellites will give us better broadband, but it's also going to clog up low Earth orbit that much more and make it that much harder not only to send satellites into safe orbits, but it's also going to get that much more hazardous for manned missions to fly through that growing debris field to get to other planets. Can you imagine being up in space and seeing random debris float by outside? That'd be an experience. And speaking of, did you know we have a sister channel called Seeker VR? It's everything you love about Seeker, but in 360 degrees. Seeker VR will take you on some incredible journeys that you probably wouldn't get to experience otherwise. Like in a recent episode, we took a ride on one of the most deadly trains in the world. Check it out here. And speaking of old space junk, the oldest dead satellite up there is Vanguard 1, launched in 1958. If you're curious about that era, check out this video from my own channel, Vintage Space. So what do you guys think about all this space junk? Let us know in the comments, be sure to give this video a like, and subscribe so you never miss an episode of Seeker.